don't worry.
I'm just remembering when they used to dub with him, Hentai. I mean, there was an episode of Ancast like a year ago where they brought in a guy from Fandom Post, and I said the question was like, why do all the Hentai releases I see, why are they all like re-releases from 10 years ago? And Chris Beveridge from Fandom Post said, the stuff coming out of Japan now is so nasty, it would be legally problematic in parts of the United States to release it. So the only things that can be safely released for Hentai are stuff from 10 years ago.
Of all the things I expected, the MuvLuv panel, dubbing Hentai was not one of them. That was going to be some problematic if the, hey, you should dub this in English part of the Kickstarter had gone through.
English, Ken? Fucking English, dude? Oh, wait, this isn't an 18 plus.
You're right.
Yeah.
Technically.
Yeah.
Not so many children. We didn't charge you. Well, actually, sorry. Actually, sorry, Proton. Cover your ears.
Douchebags?
Douchebags?
Yeah.
Douchebags. I'm going to be the only person not wearing this.
Oh, this will be crazy. Whatever.
It's technically 11:30. Let me get started here.
Let's get started.
All right. Thank you, everybody, for coming to Anime Central 2016. This is the MuvLuv panel. 8 or more minutes of death. Probably about 55 to 60 minutes of death. So I am Invalid Name. I just basically do a lot of panels on MuvLuv around the country. To my left.
Okay. I'm go by Atherdius on the MuvLuv forums. There are other places where I have gotten. Oh my! So I can't really compete to that, but I've been sort of.
For anyone listening at home, in the next room over, there is like a worst of hentai dubbing thing going on, and they have the volume really cranked. So we're kind of hearing it play through the walls.
Yeah.
We're thinking a certain scene from Alternative could kind of turn everybody off to hentai forever.
I don't know. I wouldn't want to tell anybody that group over there. Anyway, I just do community.
Turn it around.
Stop it. Yes. There we go. Community contributions, cosplay, help. And to my left, I'm Dex. I'm basically all I'm known for is. I am an admin on the community site, AniTAY. We do a lot of blogging stuff, and it just happens to be a very visible center of MuvLuv apparently these days because of our incredible love for it.
I have to say, Dex, your review is something that I point people to when I try to explain this is why this thing is cool. Oftentimes I'll just send them your link to Alternative. I won't send them so much the extra, the limited link, but I'll definitely send them the Alternative.
Yeah.
That review really sells it, really puts a TM on it.
I appreciate that. I think I was still pretty, new to that whole writing reviews thing when I did it, but I'm glad that it helped somebody. Nothing says the internet like never looking past statements and shit.
Yeah.
But luckily we can change things on the internet.
Alright, so for everybody here, Dejica has equipped us with merchandise and prizes, so we will have a series of trivia questions during the panel here. Winners will be getting a Yuko's gift bag. This is the one. You guys got this in the Kickstarter by now, right?
I haven't gotten my gift bag because I chose to.
Just wait. You
were polite.
All right. Well, what's in here is there's mini wall scroll, there's patches, there's cards, there's pins, there's pretty cool Valkyrie's medallion. It's really nice stuff. Also, for anybody, we've got lobby cards and buttons, and for prize winners, we have a large, no, detail large. We have a medium and a small on the t-shirts from Legend of Heroes. And the other upfront reminder for everybody, if my slides are working, is we do have a cosplay gathering tomorrow at 11. Just outside the Exmateria in the garden area.
It may be optimistic, but we do cover anything Aja does.
So this would be MuvLuv, Rumbling March, Smart Market, so everything there. So here's our agenda for tonight. We're going to talk about MuvLuv, Alternative, the Kickstarter. We'll cover a little bit of Dove Eclipse, Rumbling Hearts, Schwarzmarken. But Schwarzmarken at the end, because we have a mystery guest coming around midnight who's going to help us with that, so that'll be fun. And we go into the 8 minutes of info dump here. What's the familiarity level, now we just lost you people, of the with the franchise? You were here last year, so I know you know this. Who has played some or all visual novels? Hands? Who is not familiar with this franchise?
I mean, kind of. I read the manga for the center one, so now I'm sure that the extra. I read the manga for extra, but I haven't really done that one.
I think if we could do a little info dump up front to catch everybody up to where we are. Does that sound good to everybody?
Sure.
All right. So we are talking about our friends at Aj. This is a visual novel producer in Japan. Their first game was in 99. That is Kimiga Ita Kisetsu. They broke through in 2001 with Kimiga no Sumo Eien, which is also known here as Rumbling Hearts, but they're probably best known for the Muv-Luv series. The first game came out in 2003, Muv-Luv Alternative came out in 2006, and a lot of these works overlap, both in visual novels and in other realms they're interested in, like novels, they have short stories in Tech Geon magazine. There's anime, so all this stuff crosses over. There's a timeline that basically goes down. If you look at the left side here, that's going to be stuff in what we call the extraverse, which is really kind of our universe, our timeline. That's where Rumbling Hearts takes place, that's where Muv-Luv begins. But then there is an alternative timeline where the Earth is being attacked by aliens called the Beta, which we'll talk about later, and that is the Betaverse timeline, and unlimited alternative, and some of these other works take place in the Beta timelines. We've got two major timelines moving back and forth between. The first big game was Kimiga no Sumo Eien, came out in 2001. It's got fairly good ratings and reviews. There is no complete English translation of Kimiga no Sumo Eien. However, there is a fan translation underway in alternative projects, which has finished the main route and the routes for the first three heroines, Haruka, Mitsuki, and Akane. It also came out as an anime. It came out in 2003. It was picked up by Funimation in 2006, one of the first things they did that was sort of getting away from the whole Dragon Ball Focal Out, this kind of thing for them. There was also a 4-episode OAV sequel called Next Season. So I'm going to quickly summarize the story here. This is basically, there's a sporty girl, Mitsuki. She has a shy friend named Haruka. Haruka has always been interested in this boy named Takayuki, who is the player character. She finally confesses, things don't really click for them at first, but finally they start going out. But Mitsuki feels left out, so she says, oh, you should spend some time with me, and he delays her when he's supposed to be on a date with her, and she gets hit by a car while she's waiting for him, and ends up in a coma for 3 years. And in those 3 years, when he's kind of lost, she kind of gets him out of it, Mitsuki does, and they eventually become lovers. And that's probably not the best thing in the world, because Haruka then wakes up from her coma after 3 years, and her mind's not in a particularly good state, and the doctor says, you know what, she really doesn't need to know that 3 years have passed, so please don't let her know, which means as far as Haruka understands, she's still in high school, Takayuki is still her boyfriend, none of these things are true, and the more they have to indulge these lies, the worse things are going to get.
This was always a great idea.
Yeah, this is...
This is a long series of very good suggestions, life choices and suggestions from
basically everyone. Yes. What not to do, the anime. So Muv-Luv came a couple years later. That's in 2003. It's technically, it's a spin-off or a sequel of sorts to Rumbling Hearts in that it takes place in the same school. There's a couple characters that cross over. It really is its own thing, but it does share that universe. There's basically two parts to it, extra and unlimited. You begin extra and you finish two routes and that will unlock unlimited. So to talk about extra for a minute, we have the player character is Takeru. He's sort of just a goofball. He plays video games. He has a next door neighbor named Sumika. But then he wakes up one morning and there's this crazy girl named Maya. Wakes up in his bed, and she is basically determined to make him hers.
That's not a zombie, that's a childhood friend.
Yeah, that's childhood friend Sumika. And so basically this then turns into a romantic battle between the two of them, and they will compete over things by, like, you know, Sumiko will make him a bento box lunch, where Mayo will hire the world's best cooks to make him lunch because she has all the money in the world and then some. I put in the lacrosse arc because we like pain.
What are you talking about? The lacrosse arc was the best part. I mean, I just love a whole 10 hours of stories.
The irony being, it sets up so much for later in the franchise, but it is a whole lot of people talking about the need for friendship and for being teammates. Anyway, wild, wacky things happen in Extra, and eventually it is important that you pick between one of the girls, so you will either end up with Maya or Sumika, and then you will finish both of those routes, and that will take you to... If I can get to my next slide here. You get to the end. I will advance the next slide. Here we go. And then once you complete both routes, you'll be in Muv-Luv Unlimited. In Muv-Luv Unlimited, things are a little different. Like the title screen, Sumika's not there anymore, and everyone's wearing military fatigues, and there's a big giant robot crashed into the side of your house. Yeah. And you're like, what the hell has happened here?
Yeah, there was something else on that title screen, but you'll figure that out.
Yeah. So anyway, you are in a different world where an alien race called the Beta has invaded in 1973, conquered about half the planet. Everybody you know is now in military academy school, except for Sumika, who seems not to exist. As you can see, the Beta have swarmed over most of Europe and Asia rather quickly. So the people who are left are fighting back. So now your school is a military academy, and there's crazy super science going on in the basement, and you are going to be trained to fight back in giant robots called Tactical Surface Fighters, or TSFs. And the funny thing about this game is that Takeru is the ideal TSF pilot because he has been raised on video games and roller coasters. So most people, when they get into the pilot seat of a TSF, they basically throw up immediately. He's like, oh, this is nice. This is cool, I dig this. It's like the one thing he has going for him. And it's kind of fun for a while, and then it ends kind of horribly. And we can move on to our next slide. Move on to Muv-Luv Alternative, came out 3 years later. This continues the story of Unlimited, but basically resets you back to the beginning of Unlimited, and now you know everything that's going to happen in Unlimited, and you are determined for it not to happen, and that is the fact that at the end of Unlimited, there was a plan to save the world that was not really going to end particularly well for anybody. So Takeru is determined to make that not happen, and he's like, well, hey, I know what's going to happen. I can go straight to Yugo, the super scientist, and tell her everything I know. And when you reveal a whole bunch of knowledge about top secret plans, that doesn't end particularly well. And it is not received particularly well. But eventually, Yugo will work with you to try to save the world, and you'll start changing history, and...
That always goes well.
Yes, exactly. Yes. You know, nothing... You're not going to give away too much, but this is really the key part of the franchise that everybody really likes. And you'll get PTSD, and horrible things will happen. And not for nothing is this considered the best visual novel of all time. I'm going to skip ahead a slide here.
We're sarcastic about it, but yeah, it's absolutely worth not spoiling as much as possible, but appreciating it as much as you can.
We do have several rules in place in AniTAY about what we talk about.
Alright, I'm going to move on to the next slide here so we can keep the show rolling. What
we talk about? 5 hours of lacrosse is worth that, so yes.
Yeah, honestly. So our aliens are called the Beta. They are carbon-based life forms. Yes, thank you for the slide. Carbon-based life forms, they were spotted on Mars in, what, the 50s or 60s?
Yeah, they were first spotted in, like, yeah. The 50s or
60s. They show up, the history prior to the invasion is a little different. The space probes go out earlier in the revised timeline.
There's, like, rovers on Mars far earlier. Or what it didn't go quite the same way.
Yeah, there's minor differences. But anyway, so these guys, kind of bad news. They conquer half the planet. They eat humans to regenerate themselves. They build these structures called hives where they're binding the Earth and they're ejecting matter into space, and they're basically just out of control bioengineered mining robots, and we are simply in their way. I'm just going to go through this nice collection of these really, really freaking scary looking designs here.
What are you talking about? That looks adorable.
Oh!
If we get the plushie for them.
There's going to be a plushie. Him too.
Okay, yeah, that's terrifying.
Yeah, that's pretty bad. And also, coming up next is the fourth class. Oh, no, no, warrior class. We see a lot of warrior class.
No, well, usually it's brief or they're very small. I don't think they come up in the visual rules, at least on screen.
That guy.
Just to cover a couple of things, a few more points about the info dump on the franchise before we start talking. You know, Total Eclipse was a spinoff. This is set in the Betaverse. It's a couple months before the main MuvLuv alternative storyline. This has to do with test pilots in Alaska. One is Japanese, the other is half Japanese, half American. This got a 24-episode anime by Satellite. It was dubbed by Sentai. It's also on Crunchyroll. Then just this winter we got an anime of Schwarzenmarken. This is set in 1983, so you know, 18 years before most of our MuvLuv stuff, in East Germany, for those of you who are old enough to remember that Germany was once two different countries. A lot of fans don't. It's kind of funny that way. That's streamed on Crunchyroll. Other fun things. Akane Maniacs is a comedy visual novel, got a 3-episode anime. This is sort of a sequel to Rumbling Hearts and a prequel to MuvLuv Extra. And it's told from the point of view of this obnoxious guy who's basically sexually harassing Akane from Rumbling Hearts. And it will directly set up MuvLuv Extra. There's a lot of crossover in this universe. There's things like MuvLuv Unlimited The Day After, which shows it's like a sequel to Unlimited but before Alternative. Shows what happens when Alternative 5 is put into effect.
It's basically what happens when you let Unlimited run its course and get to watch.
Time points are fun.
It doesn't turn out particularly well for anyone.
Anybody. It's probably a good thing the history resets after that.
Yeah.
We have Altered Fable, which is what happened to the extra timeline after Alternative changed it. Dex, you got a review of that on
Night Attack!
And many more. I just want to mention a couple crossovers here. The girl with the glasses, I went blank on her name, Chizuru. She's sort of been retconned as the gal pal of Akane from Rumbling Hearts, so you see her show up in a bunch of stuff. Some of the characters from Rumbling Hearts show up as TSF pilots in Alternative. Scene on the left is from a post-credit scene in Akane Maniacs, where Haruka from Rumbling Hearts hands over the franchise to Sumika from MuvLuv, and then on the right there is something called AniTAY Theater, where the idiot waitresses from Rumbling Hearts just sort of make a mess of the Osh universe. So, time for a trivia question. So we're ready to give away one of our Yuko gift bags here. So we'll just look to see who gets a hand up first. Question one, which of these TSFs is about to die and why?
Don't worry, we didn't actually tell you about this.
Yep. Who do you think is going to die in this shot? He indicated a TSF by its position or color or anything. What do you say?
The red one because it's highest.
The red one because it's highest.
What? Don't worry about it. As long as you don't fly so high that you...
I don't like the red.
Water.
We have our winner. So remember, with laser class beta, do not fly high.
Yes, however, I think I might have also accepted everyone.
Everybody except the main character, yes. All right, so let's quickly talk about the Kickstarter here. That Kickstarter raised $1.2 million. And what was originally, it was trying to do
$250,000?
$250,000. So what, 5 times their goal? 1.5 times what Clannad or Saya made?
Yeah, it was awesome.
Why was this so successful? I've talked a lot here. Why do you think this Kickstarter worked so well?
Well, I think there was a lot of pent-up, we definitely want this. And there were a lot of people opening their walls pretty wide, and that's myself included, famously. They didn't really, a lot of Kickstarters didn't end, go very well, especially like the Clannad Kickstarter, with a lot of available wonderful prizes and things to pay you lots of money for. I know, given how much Volks likes to charge for their figures, the MuvLuv fandom has never been above spending large swaths of money. And it was joked frequently that it was only about 10 people who were bankrolling most of it, but it went along pretty well. Well, being number one listed, well-known, best visual novel, it stands pretty well. So
though. People will follow one to say, all right, fine. I didn't feel like downloading this illegally for some inexplicable reason. And give someone some money and see what the world is all this is about.
Well, in addition to just people opening their wallets a lot, Ajay and Degika were pretty generous with just their handling of the whole thing.
Yeah.
I mean, those like type C tiers up in the like 800s region, where they those ran out pretty quickly. But then they came back and said, yeah, we're adding a whole bunch more. And, you know, that certainly helps when you're able to expand tiers like that as much as they did. It certainly increases the hype as well.
Yeah, I think it's also really nice that they gave us a lot of lead time on that. I know some Kickstarters will just sort of like surprise everybody and get that news out. But this one, they announced it at AX, then they had a pre-fund. It didn't actually launch for another 3 or 4 months. If you wanted to save up for something big, you had a couple of paychecks to put away money so you could buy like a $400 or $500 item. I think that was pretty smart, and I don't see people doing that. I think that was a lesson to learn.
I was saving for this before I knew about it.
I think part of it is also it helped to build on when the what's the Clannad Kickstarter one, especially after and all the other many other. It was the year of big gift Kickstarters. We also had several other games that people had been dreaming about, and it was a good time. And one of the things that seems to help Kickstarters a lot is really good communication. And Digica was really good about answering questions quickly and talking and making sure everyone knew what was up. And that.
This is how you want to handle a Kickstarter. Yeah. It really is a model of people. I would like to see more Kickstarters take some lessons from this. They really do a great job. A couple of slides I'm showing here have actually come out from the translators. So this is an early peek. They sent me one like an hour ago. This is a side-by-side comparison. The top slide there is the old extract translation. I didn't even have it built there. Why did that disappear? And the bottom is the new one. The other thing, of course, you can tell is you have the new HD assets. So everything's going to be a widescreen. Everything's just looking a lot nicer.
And they upgraded to the next edition versions and all the other nice.
Yeah. We'll be running on the new engine because I could never get the old version to install on Windows 10 that I had installed on XP. So just running on modern hardware is going to be nice. All right. Try to get on my next slide here. It's not letting me. Keynote is fighting me tonight. So MuvLuv Extra. Well, let's try to keep this to about 5 minutes, or, what is that, 1/100th the length of what Dross are? We give the Extra a lot of crap, but I do want to ask this. This is for Dex. You said in your review of Alternative that, Alternative justifies the whole franchise.
Yes, I found Extra to be terrible when I first played it.
Right.
Like, legitimately terrible.
And you said, you would never play Extra in Unlimited and just stop there.
No.
Now, on the flip side of that, though, could you read like a cheat sheet for what's covered in Extra and then just play Alternative? Or is it really important you actually do play Extra?
Generally speaking, I'm going to have to say you've got to play Extra. You have to play. You can't just do a cheat sheet. But that's mostly because you're going to get trolled so hard by Extra and you won't realize it until well after the fact. And I thought that was almost one of the most incredible things that happened.
I really dig the fact that it's not like I think it's like Escaflowne. You get like the girls in our world for 10 minutes, and then she's off in the other world for like the rest of the series. You and MuvLuv get immersed in this guy's life for 30 or 40 hours of Extra.
You get to see his most boring life, where the most boring things happen to him, and he has such first world problems. And you'll say, my God, I want to get on with this. I want to get to the good part. And you'll get to the good part, you'll go back to Extra, and not only will you think to yourself, man, it was so nice back when we had these first world problems, you'll also notice all those times where Koki was subtly messing with you all throughout it, and it is absolutely incredible to watch him as he does that to you repeatedly.
And to know how far ahead things were planned in this series really is amazing.
I mean, I did a whole thing on Twitter that the is where I went back and played through extra, and I was starting to see what we call the epileptic trees. If you go to TV tropes very often, you start seeing things that might not actually be there. It's so mean.
You know, Koki is also not above trolling even for the things he didn't plan. So I remember, we asked, there was a question about the translation, I think, for the pilot's name or something, and Ezra was, I just thought it sounded cool, I don't care.
Thanks
for that. And we argued for 3 weeks or something about it.
Well, that certainly happened with Schwarz's market, as it turned out, because, I mean, anyone who knows anything about German knows that that name makes absolutely no sense in German whatsoever. And the justification in the universe is, a Russian officer said it and thought it was cool.
That's weird. They have a way of just sort of, you know, soft chewing those things with retcons, but after a while it gets ridiculous.
But at the same time, this is a nuts, insane world, and it's kind of normal when you think about it.
Now, the other thing about Extra is, the one thought I have about this is that the readme that came with the Amoratsu translation says, literally, the first line of the readme is, welcome to the worst game we have ever done.
Yeah.
Now, they don't like Extra. The people at Alternative Projects, they like both the Extraverse and the Betaverse. Do you think it's possible when we get Extra, the new translation, it's actually going to be better, that we might enjoy Extra this time?
Well, I'm sure they're going to try to make it the best they possibly can. Now, how you can make the lacrosse arc better, I cannot say, but I'm sure they'll try.
I don't know. I think a lot of, even with not knowing Alternative, you really have to appreciate very subtle, like, referencing and digs at the entire genre and everything at its time. Although I can fully appreciate having to translate several metric volumes of text of someone's very specific, subtle fandom references, basically trying to translate a phone book worth of one person's fan fiction makes you really want to hurt yourself by the end of that. You can appreciate it on principle as we can, but we didn't have to go through all that text editing.
Does this work as a deconstruction of harem stuff, or is it just literally harem stuff?
It is a good parody of that genre. Now, whether it needed to be parodied, that is also a good question.
I kind of feel with harem stuff, it's like the first time you see it, it's really cool, because there's nothing in the West like that. So, like, if you're my age, it's like Love Hina came out, and that was great. I mean, for teenagers today, they've never seen something like Nisekoi, but you really only need it once, right?
Yeah. We certainly try to give most of them a chance, and most of them aren't very good, but we certainly try.
Alright. I don't think anybody really talks about that much, because they want to move on to Alternative. What do we say about Unlimited?
Unlimited is a bit of an oddity. I mean, like we say, it's technically the second part to the first visual novel, so you don't know about it until,
After you finish extra,
and once you get to it, you go, oh, this might be interesting, which is almost word for word what I said when I saw that. And yeah, you know, you start up, and it's basically just a shot for extra, with the added benefit of, you know, aliens trying to kill you.
Well, you never see them.
You never see them in Unlimited, which is part of why it doesn't really come across as a life or death scenario. It just seems like, instead of being in a teenager's shoes inside of a school with first world problems, now you're inside a military academy with problems like, I got dropped on an island and now I have to survive for several days.
Or problems like, I got my fellow cadet addicted to video games that I brought from a parallel reality. It's like, they're very lightweight problems considering the severity of the situation.
Yeah, it's pretty weird in that it does an interesting job of easing you into a very different reality and really not changing the formula at all. And that's probably why people don't like to talk about it very much. It's essentially the same thing as Extra with a different twist.
I kind of like the fact that they're taking their time getting you and getting Takeru used to the Betaverse and used to being a military guy. I once used the analogy, this is like The Empire Strikes Back if the only thing in that movie was Luke training with Yoda. Like, it's just that and it's nothing else. Which is kind of cool because I like that. That's my favorite part of The Empire Strikes Back. But there's literally nothing else.
If you're saying that Yuko's Yoda, I mean, I would suspect it's
she's hotter.
She also scares me. Either I would expect that the training would be a lot more painful, or there could be something for having to run around with Yuko's on your back. That's a totally different thing.
I think we should give away another prize at this point. I think that's my next slide. Yeah, we got a prize here. All right, trivia question two. Let's see if we can distribute the love around the room a little bit here. So we tried to make these pretty easy so people can get them. So question two is, there was never a MuvLuv Extra anime, so where is this scene from? Anybody want to raise a hand and get this? We already talked about this. Over here.
Total Eclipse.
It is not from Total Eclipse, I'm sorry. Anyone else want to take a guess? In the back. The Spore OVAs. You're really close. Starts with an A, ends with an X. Should you just give it away? Mikey?
You want it?
Yeah, it's like a climax or something like that.
Thank you.
So, Mikey, maybe even say that.
Can we get prizes?
I want to say how much
of the people getting the
specific joking about the genre that Akane Maniacs more specifically does. Yeah, let's be honest. Go that should totally be a Gundam.
Well, yeah.
Which is. Of the most ludicrous manga series.
Yeah, I always thought he was a parody of that.
Yeah.
So, he's like the one person who would want to be in the Betaverse and isn't.
Yes.
Well, he'd also probably be one person. He'd probably be one person that.
I would name Joe probably that.
In fact, now we bring it up and call he is in that universe.
What's that thing called?
The other thing worth noting in Akane Maniacs, this is the credits from the final episode. They get the MuvLuv theme song. It really is. MuvLuv has completely taken over the franchise. Alternative. God, where do we start with alternative? Given that we have 25 minutes left. We're going to be waiting until the end of the year for the visual novel for this. We have to play through the other ones first. But what do you think the most striking thing about alternative to you?
It's a complete tonal shift.
Yeah.
Like, just from the start, it's a complete tonal shift. Because the entirety, even Unlimited, was pretty much a romantic comedy. With, you know, only light elements. I mean, it only gets dark in a couple of particular instances, particularly at the end of Unlimited, and, you know, any of the problems you experience in Extra are just basically melodrama. But you get into Alternative, and right out of the gate, there's, like, no music. There's no real talking. Takaru gets up, and he's basically just thinking to himself, where am I? Wait, I'm back where I started. And, you know, previously, he would have been, you know, like, oh man, that's awesome.
Yes.
But now,
he knows what's coming.
Now he's like, well, I'm back here. I guess I'm going to have to, go and save myself in the world from what's going to happen because I know something bad happened. And that's a complete tonal shift from anything we saw in the previous entries.
I mean, the risk taking of it is really remarkable, too. I mean, the things that are set up even in the previous games and then get pulled off are just so audacious all the time. And I don't want to give any spoilers away, but certain revelations in that game that maybe you saw coming, I didn't see coming. I was just like, wow, I cannot believe they did that.
Well, after a certain point, I was not predicting any of this. Not getting too spoiled, but around the December area. Everything around then, it's completely unexpected for a franchise that starts out as romantic comedy. It just comes out of nowhere, essentially.
And the other thing I feel about this is, I mean, when you take a step back from this, you say, well, it's called MuvLuv because that title was a joke, and, you know, it was never really meant to just stand for the whole franchise. And at the end of the game, I actually do think it is about a love story. In a huge, epic way, one that stretches across timelines, it does become what people would do for someone they love, how they would bend space and time, what they would sacrifice for. It's really surprising. It actually, you know, when you get to the end of Alternative, it really does come back around to some of those things that were set up way back at the beginning of Extra.
Yeah. We have an explanation about the love part.
Yeah, the love can't be helped.
Yeah, I think that was just there for alliteration, but at least in so far as the Japanese alliteration.
but I've had some very long discussions with one of our members on AniTAY Exile, and we can get into it about what the core premise of MuvLuv really is. And eventually we kind of settle around the idea of it is a love story, as strange as it ends up being.
And as much, you know, horror is involved in it, too. Right?
Yeah.
I mean, I think you said this is steps away from being a straight-up horror title at times,
it
right?
It can be. It was just gruesome and weird. I don't like to think about it sometimes.
Well, I'm showing clips here from the fence at the base, where this is Mitsuki and Takaru taking out some of the laser glass in the main core. This is, even, you know, in its day, this was remarkable-looking visual novel. I don't know a lot of visual novels that try to do, technically, the kinds of things that MuvLuv tries to do.
I don't think anyone's ever claimed that anyone has a better system than Ajumon does there, which was incredibly difficult for the original translators to have to deal with, too.
Yes, the power of the rugby.
Yeah. Yeah, and I guess that's a striking thing about Alternative 2. All things considered, the first game was not very technically impressive at all.
And yet,
the production values for Alternative go way further
up. And they, you know, it doesn't like put it all out front right away. You know, scenes like this, where you're doing video compositing stuff, this is a good 30 hours into the game before it shows, oh hey, I can do this too.
Yeah. Although I will point out to Jam Project singing an opening song at the beginning when you start up the game.
That set the bar higher.
That's fair.
And yet, when Operation Cherry Blossom launches, you go a little higher than that.
Right. It's also worth pointing out, maybe, that the... for those of you who may not be super familiar with the visual novels, all of that is like cell animation or 3D. Those are transforms applied to 2D bitmaps. The system does in real time to create false animation, which is mind-boggling to some extent.
And it's fast as it runs.
And less so on Windows 7 emulation, but it does require a beefy version.
I don't want to rush things, but since Alternative is the core of the franchise, is there anything else you guys want to get in about Alternative?
No, I'm not.
Redux is for you on AniTAY.
Yeah.
It really is the... I don't want to say it's the final word on it. It really is a good summary of what's so good about Alternative. Alright. I think we should be getting stuff with... I think this was with HTC. They did a virtual reality game based on MuvLuv as a tech demo. And so you are an infantryman, you're not even in a TSF.
That's
running around trying not to get chomped by tank beta. That would be scary as hell.
And people thought the XTC demo where you were trying to save the cat from a ledge was terrifying.
I thought Far Away Dawn was bad enough, and then they give you this where you're
and
infantryman.
Like blocking out all your sensory input and just saying, yeah, you're in the betaverse now, we're about to get chomped.
Do they have therapists on hand?
I thought that should be a Kickstarter reward.
That's their other application they're developing.
All right, trivia question 3. Oh, this was yours. What is the most common strain of beta? Also for bonus, least common. You don't want to take a guess. Most common strain of beta. Yeah. What was that? Laser glass is not the most common.
Thank goodness.
Yeah, that would be a problem.
It'd be a little bit, it's kind of lopsided.
Yeah, I suppose this mark would be a little different.
Let's
start the strains.
Okay.
Yeah, let's
start
the strains really quick.
Oh, it's okay, a little bit.
Yeah, so, let's see. What was it? We got Fort Warrior. Well, so the big one is the Fort. If we go down from there, it's Grappler.
That was in Destroyer, Grappler.
Destroyer,
tank.
Grappler, Tank. The two lasers,
Warrior,
laser,
lasers,
laser, and then infantry size.
Soldier, Warrior, crazy Ford lasers, right?
Yeah.
Well, let's not bring the weird hybrid things that they decided to start throwing into the mix. Give them enough time.
So, anybody who saw the next slide want to go and get your free gift? What was it?
Tank?
Why, yes, the tank class is the most common. Least common is fort class, thank goodness. Yeah. I always thought one of the clever things is that a fort class can act as a troop carrier for smaller beta. That is messed up. So you can kill a fort class, think, hey, this is great, cut it open, and a whole bunch of beta crawl out. And that's just because
that's what we need.
I think we just saw one of those pictures of one of those spiders doing that.
Yeah, I'll avoid them thinking about that. Yeah. I don't want to sleep in game.
So, a couple thoughts here on Total Eclipse. We only got half of this story. Is it worth it?
That's a difficult question.
If you got the second half of it, if Satellite came back with 25 more episodes and finished the story, how do you think you feel about Total Eclipse?
Probably a bit better.
Yeah.
I mean, Total Eclipse as it stands, they of course have some animated fights, which aren't quite as impressive as they could be. It was a different time back then. Couldn't do nearly as much with their animation.
But it's Satellite. They know how to do Macs. I mean, they're always making Macross.
Yeah. I always just remember when I was watching the show thinking they're like doing a simulation or something where Yuya is fighting a bunch of beta, and I'm just thinking to myself when I'm watching it, that's not all that many beta.
Sir Surprise is the test pilot for the middle of nowhere. Oh man, that's so many.
But I mean, Total Eclipse, it's essentially, it is a MuvLuv anime. It has awesome mechs. I love TSFs, by the way.
It's got a harem element. Yeah. Unfortunately, but yeah. It's got a harem thing going on.
Well, that's going to be the divisive part of it, really.
Yeah.
I would kind of argue that, assuming that they weren't ever going to get anything else, the Total Eclipse kind of works as a very broad summary of everything from Extra Thrill Alternative, just not in any particular order.
Yeah.
So we do get a lot of lacrosse in the middle.
The Blue Flag is basically a lacrosse art.
Yeah.
That's really good, I like that.
One of my old shames is I didn't watch this anime before I played this game.
I like the end of this part of Total Eclipse, how much it builds up to nothing happens for a very long time, then suddenly there's it's not as much of a total shift as doing another things, but it at least gives someone a brief taste of
it. I think you're understanding that. We go from onsen episode to,
yeah,
let's
have
a war.
Arguably we go from a recap to a war after onsen, then recap to a war. That's a play.
Hey there.
Greetings.
So, this is a rare treat. Usually in MuvLuv we don't gain characters halfway through.
I know, right?
Darren, I'm gonna suggest right now, do not tell your life story and what you're fighting for, because in MuvLuv that means you're gonna die by the end of the chapter.
Actually, the most experienced of us is probably the one going down, so
who is that? Uh-oh. So, we're going to do a trivia question, and we've just been joined here by Darren Martin, who reviewed Schwarz's Market for Anime News Network. Let's do a trivia question, and then we'll skip to Schwarz's Market, okay? So trivia question 4. Having lost entire territory to beta, the USSR relocates its capital and population to which U.S. state? You're Russia, what? Give that man a Yuko's gift bag.
Well, at least all the Russians, all the
Alright, I'm going to skip our slides ahead. Here they are. To Schwarz's Market. And one piece of news worth noting is the visual novel for Schwarz's Market has been approved by Steve Greenlight. So at some point we may see the visual novel for that in the future. We got this on Crunchyroll earlier in the year. Darren reviewed the show for Anime News Network. Thank you, Darren. Darren, I'm going to throw this first question out to you. I hope it's not too mean, but did anybody else at ANN want Schwarz's Market, or were you in? Maybe get the microphone close to you.
Beyond the first episode, I don't think there's anybody else on staff following.
Yeah, because I remember both Nick and Jacob were not really fans with the preview guide.
Yeah, I gave it kind of a middling grade in the Family Guy, but I went ahead and agreed to review it because there's a definite history aspect to it. And that's what really attracted me to the series.
Darren, are you old enough to remember East Germany?
Oh yeah. I mean, I'm in my 40s.
Okay, good.
I quite clearly remember the whole Berlin Wall, the whole Berlin Wall falling and all that, so.
I think that's an interesting thing about the fandom for the show, and in some cases the people who don't like it. There was a review, one of the Crunchyroll viewers said, "This is so crazy. I can't imagine anything that would cause Germany to break up." I'm like, try losing World War II.
Yeah, that's something I thought was kind of curious too, is if people that are a little bit older and thus have a little bit more of a historical context for what actually was going on with Germany might actually appreciate that series more. One thing I definitely noticed as I was going through the series, and I commented on this a lot in the reviews, is that for as much as there's an altered timeline because of all the presence of the betas and all that, it's actually sticks remarkably close to a lot of historical details about East Germany.
The things like the Stasi files.
Oh yeah, the Stasi files absolutely existed. And they absolutely did have as many as was shown in the show. There was no exaggeration there. I think I read somewhere that the page count for the Stasi files numbered in the billions.
And paper. I mean, that was not electronic paper, records in those days.
Yes, they had files on, I believe, something like 6 million people. So what you see in the series, that scene late in the series where was, I don't remember, I want to say his name was Axman. Am I right about that?
Yeah, Axman. I think he's in the running for your Bastard of the Year.
Oh, yeah. He definitely is. But when Axman shows off to Gretel, it was Gretel, right?
Yeah, Gretel was the... Right.
Yeah, when Axman shows off to Gretel, that whole big vault where they have the Stasi files, well, they might not have actually kept him in a big vault like that, but that volume definitely existed.
I was really impressed. There were those two guys who were in Germany today. One was actually, they're both born in the eastern part of the country. One actually has an East Germany birth certificate. We're doing those YouTube videos where they go over the episodes.
Yeah, I watched a few of those.
Yeah, and in detail about how much they got right and wrong. And they got a lot more right in Schwarzenmarken than not. That was really impressive.
Oh yeah. I mean, all the paranoia stuff they bred in the anime series, that was real. I mean, there were, what was the figures I saw? Something like one out of every 50 German citizens was either part-time or full-time employee of the Stasi.
Was a member of it? Yeah, that should be about correct.
Yeah, I mean, it's an amazingly high number. I mean, in terms of the volume and oppressiveness of the police state created by the Stasi, they were worse than the Nazis, they were worse than the KGB.
Well, the whole idea that they had in mind with the whole informants everywhere thing was simply that you wouldn't know who it was. So the idea was to just have just enough of them that anyone could be one.
Oh yeah. So the paranoia they show in the series, that all the characters had, that was very, very real.
It's right on.
Now, Darren, what was your familiarity level, if any, with the Muv-Luv franchise before you saw Schwarzenmarken?
Going into that, I'd seen the earlier anime series,
Total Eclipse,
yeah. I'd seen that one, so
I had covered that.
Yeah, I had at least some familiarity with the franchise, but
I mean, it's one of the things.
Sorry, that was
a good thing. Yeah, the core problem with the series is the best part of it has never been animated. It's like they've animated everything in Oz but the main part, visual novels, which makes it just very difficult for us as. Because I remember I discussed you on the forums, like you were unaware that ultimately this is all a spin-off of Rumbling Hearts.
Yeah, that was total news to me. It's like, if you want to talk about two series that you would never guess are connected, I would never have seen that connection.
Well, it's sort of like Lisa going turning into Attack on Titan. Yeah, that's
yeah, it's like proposition. They're kids 100 generations later or something. Now that one, yeah, that revelation really caught me off guard.
Now, this was adapted from 7 light novels down to a 12-episode anime. Did it feel rushed to anybody here?
A little bit of time, but honestly, I didn't think the pacing on it was that bad. I've definitely seen way worse jobs.
I think this might be more of a case of the Japanese core system was not going to play kind with this one. I mean, 16 might have been the sweet number.
Would you have been good with this as a 24-episode series?
I don't know.
That would have been dragging.
There would have been some filler, or they would have had to cope with another arc.
There were a lot of hot springs in Germany. But let's not talk about that. I don't want to think about that episode. I mean, there are some light novel series that you can adapt to, like, two or three episodes per light novel, and then there are some that you can do six or seven. I mean, to give you a comparison, the original novel for the Mother's Rosario arc of Sword Art Online, single novel that it was adapted into seven episodes quite smoothly. So it just varies so much from series to series as to what kind of pacing works. Yeah, exactly. Well, Spice and Wolf was going about six episodes per novel throughout. So, I mean, some series can handle that. Then you have, on the other side of the scale, you have Danmachi, which was like just 2 to 3 episodes per light novel. You have that. It's in cases. So, but that still worked pretty well. So,
yeah, speaking of light novels, this started as a light novel. So did Total Eclipse. Would you be interested? You know, someone like Yen or Vertical started publishing these.
I'd be willing to take a look at it. I mean, there's definitely some other titles that I've actually started following through the light novels, like The Devil is a Part-Timer, for instance. That's now up to the fourth light novel, which is two beyond where the anime series went. So.
Okay. We got about 5 minutes left before we should clear out. We can either cover Rumbling Hearts or take questions. So what should we do? People have questions for the panel? Got questions, or should we kick around Rumbling Hearts for 5 minutes?
I'd like to kick around Rumbling Hearts. I'd like to see how the heck this integrates in with
Oh boy. That's a fun question.
Can we answer the question without mentioning alternative?
You have romantic drama, and then you have romantic drama. So.
I want to mention with Rumbling Hearts real quick. I have my slides up for it. This is the 15th anniversary of the visual novel.
Hooray.
There's a fan translation visual novel underway. As I said earlier, they've finished the main route and the first three heroines of it. They've got a clip of it running in an emulator. There's Mitsuki and Haruka. And Darren, you actually reviewed Rumbling Hearts, one of those DVDs, way back in the day, right?
I think I reviewed the whole series.
Yeah.
This was like pretty relatively early on in my my reviewing career.
The other thing about Rumbling Hearts today is it's like, you know, today you would look at that and you'd say, oh, this is a moe title. This is going to be like some key thing. It's really not like that at all, right? I mean, it's not.
Key likes to slowly build up to their trauma. Koki, he doesn't want to spend the time doing that.
Right. Rumbling Hearts isn't his too impatient for that.
Yeah.
It goes right for the thrill. That the second episode.
Yeah, that's the car crash in the second episode, and it keeps hitting you over and over again. Yeah. But it's like, oh, they didn't just do that. Oh, they did. Yep, they did. Oh my God, yes.
Yeah, and he's never stopped doing that, and I appreciate a man of conviction like that.
Well, you know, supposedly he did a lot of research on post-traumatic stress disorder to write Rumbling Hearts, and that's one of the things that carries over into Muv-Luv. And that, you know, your character in Alternative is totally a PTSD case. In fact, you get the same green-haired demon nurse looking after you, who is the bad ending in Rumbling Hearts.
Yeah. Wow.
So, look at my notes here for this. Would the visual novel for this make a good Kickstarter? Is this too obscure? Do people not play romantic dramas for? Do you think this would be a good Kickstarter for the visual novel?
I think it's possible.
I think if this was 7, 8, or 9 years ago, yeah, I would say yes. Nowadays, I would say probably no.
You think it's made a guess all day?
Yes.
Depends on how much they want for it, because I think maybe if they were going for the level of the even then, $250,000 might be a little bit difficult to get.
Yeah.
I hate to say it.
Do you think people who like Muv-Luv should watch Rumbling Hearts? Do you like the visual novels of Muv-Luv?
I don't think it's necessary, because, I mean, he didn't realize that there was a connection between them, and that's a completely valid thing to not realize. I went back to watch Rumbling Hearts after the fact, and it's interesting to see these callbacks, and you can see the groundwork for Muv-Luv getting laid early on, but there is no direct connection, really, beside the character.
It's
been perfectly good, like there's humor at the expense of Sumika.
Yeah. The only way to truly connect them is you have to go between the anime and the visual novels. We don't have everything in one place. because we don't have, there was never a level of anime, and we don't have the Rumbling Hearts visual novels in English. So you'd have to, as an English speaker, watch the Rumbling Hearts anime, then play the MuvLuv visual novels to get the way those connect. And that's just not realistic. Alright, we have one more gift bag to give away. So, trivia question 5. Everybody hates this name Rumbling Hearts. Everyone blames Funimation for it. Not Funimation's fault. Aj came up with this. Rumbling Hearts is the name of an insert song, but it's also the name of this game when it was released in an all-ages version for a console. What platform was this released on and called Rumbling Hearts?
Guesses are totally valid.
Yes, this is totally meant to be a guesser. For what platform did they make the visual novel Kimi Ga no Mahan and rename it Rumbling Hearts? Anybody?
Oh, I've actually heard this movie from somewhere.
Think of gaming platforms from about 10 to 15 years ago.
Here's a hint. It's not.
We got a guess in the back.
PlayStation 1.
Oh, I was about to give it to you.
10 years.
Come on. Should we say that's close?
Yeah.
It was the PlayStation 2.
Proton, you're getting a stern talking to from me later.
Come get your prize.
To bring up some of the PlayStation 1 visual novels.
Did they have visual novels for PlayStation 1?
I suppose they did, but they must really want to do it. Like, count like Sakura Tyson type era stuff, or LAR.
Is that what, is that what you meant?
We're supposed to give them 5 minutes to clear out the room. Does anybody have anything else you want to get in about anything in the MuvLuv franchise? Questions?
Particularly, I think everything's pretty much explained. I feel like anything that I could possibly ask, if it was explained further, would probably spoil too much for me. So I'm kind of doing so with my...
We're not telling you what the brain is.
We're perfectly capable of answering really obsessive character or TSF questions also.
Do you think that the Vita stretch goal was another thing that got people to give our any money for the Kickstarter as well? Or not?
That's a great question. Was the Vita stretch goal a key to the Kickstarter?
I don't know if it was necessarily key, but it certainly got a lot more activity out of it. I'm not sure how much it directly was responsible for.
Was that like the second stretch goal? It came fairly early.
It came fairly early. It certainly helped things along. I mean, Vita owners do love to break out the wallets. I'm, of course, no exception. I've got a physical version of both the Vita and the PC coming back.
Nice.
Is there an overlap between the MuvLuv fandom who will open their wallets and the Vita fandom will open their wallets? They just seem to mesh nicely for this? Well, I mean, Vita owners are a very hardcore bunch, so I bet so.
Yeah. Okay, I think we're getting our countdown here.
Oh,
so.
No.
Okay, so the franchise is being re-released and redone, Northern English, whatever. You are tasked with coming up with one sentence as a tagline to sell the franchise.
One sentence tagline to sell the franchise.
Would you like PTSD?
Yes.
I don't know if that's
would
a
you
positive?
Like PTSD with that?
You say that's not positive, but I don't know.
Save in the name of true love. Let's leave it at that. All right. Thank you, everybody, for coming. Thank you for all of our panelists. It was really fun to do this.
Reminder to watch it. Thank you. Our cosplay, you know, since basically probably all of us there, or us there tomorrow, that we don't expect a whole lot more people, but we accept non-cosplayers who want to just talk random Aj and MuvLuv stuff.
And plug your blogs and sites. Dash.
Sure. All right, well, our website is AniTAY.org, AniTAY.org, and we basically do just general anime, light novel, and manga stuff, usually reviews, news, whatever we get our hands on. We're a community-based blog.
And Darren, has anyone heard of your site?
I would hope so. I've seen the numbers on. We are the ANN is the largest English language anime-oriented site in the world, so. Like over 100,000 hits a day, I think is great.
That is great.
And if you have any more questions, we have an official MuvLuv the forum, or any of the questions on the Steam page. Feel free to drop in and ask anyone any questions. And thanks everybody for coming.
Thanks for coming.
together up so the next group can get in here and
not miss it for time.
When is the steam up? Pretty special coming.
It's late.